was no talk about Scribus planned at all, but then there was, so some people wished to hear something about Scribus, so I just thought I'd give some ideas and about some possible directions Scribus can move on, and then we can have an open discussion on that. So, as you might know, we have been working on version 1.3.5 for a very, very long time now, but it's coming to an end. So today, string freeze was announced, so the release of 1.3.5 is in sight, and we have lots of ideas we want to do with in 1.3.6 and what to do on. And it's not all decided, so it's just possibilities here. So I'll go some into that and then present two ideas of mine, and then we'll go on. Then you have a discussion, if that's all. Okay. Future directions for Scribus. So one thing is we did in the past for some stuff, and it's always a possibility just for InDesign and extend Scribus to make it a second InDesign. Of course, that's kind of boring and not really wanted. We will do it in some ways because InDesign in some ways are all right, but it's not the real target we have want to do. The next thing we should... Okay. The next big scope we should concentrate on is usability. This is, for example, the GUI. So there are lots of areas where the GUI isn't optimal. Improve the documentation. So of course now we have a manual, so we are don't have that much to do there. Other things are platform integration with Windows and OS X or interoperability and stuff like that. So another one big thing will be interoperability. We have now several Google Summer of Code projects which work with address this. For example, we have one project that want to provide export and import functions for Express, so Quark Express files, and for InDesign. So this is not full Quark Express, but there's this dialect called Express Text, which is mainly used for just text, but we want to support that. And InDesign has just opened XML interchange format, and so we want to support that also. And of course, ODF, Open Document Format, can also be improved. We can also already import open documents as text frames, but of course there's also, for example, graphics or whole documents just cannot convert it to a Scribus document right now. And there's another student who's interested in implementing that. And another one thing, which is also a Google Summer of Code project, is to support more PDFX dialects. And for example, I'm not really sure if it's 1A or 1B now, which is mainly used. I think it was 1A. That's for printing exchange without ICC profiles. Scribus already does PDFX3, and so there's also now PDFX4, and I think also PDFX5, which are slight extensions on PDFX3, so it makes sense to support that also. And of course, there's lots of other stuff with interoperability which could be improved. Well, but the interesting thing, of course, is to go to the new frontiers develop use case or support use cases that Scribus right now does not support really. So one thing which is often asked for is HTML output. The problem of HTML output is that screen sizes are always different. And browser window sizes are even more different. And Scribus is, from its philosophy, it has a fixed layout. So usually there's a fixed page relation, and we have exact positions for all elements on the page. And that does not translate optimally to HTML documents. So I have no idea if we are going to tackle it in the near future or anyone at any time, just because of that. So, but it's often asked for. Another use case which is only partially supported right now by Scribus is building documents from databases. There are several flavors. So one which is partially supported is building documents, kind of a mail merge module. We have a Python script which can access databases and then just create text frames, which is not optimal, but it works somehow. Another thing, of course, is that if you have a magazine or a journal and you pull old stories from a database and can place them into the layout and mix it like that. For example, if you have a system for a newspaper and it's database backed and you want to use Scribus as a front end, so that's not really feasible right now. So, and one thing which would be connected to the talk we just heard before is have content accessible via web dev. So, for example, you can have stories on the server and access them via web dev, or have images on the server and access those and put them together in your layout. Okay, another use case which is not supported right now by Scribus is PDFA. I don't know how many of you know that PDF dialect. It's A stands for archive. And it's quite just a reduction of the current PDF file format as we use it. But it also needs something which is called tagged PDF, which means that you tag every single text which is in the PDF file about its usage. So, for example, you can tell if this is just a footer, and you can just ignore it if you want to reproduce it, or if it's meaningful text. And you have to reproduce it, and also you have to have information how the text is linked. If it's text is split in several boxes, you have to tell them which box comes first and then next, and when the story ends. So that's also a very large target which we could tackle sometime in the future. But especially with new frontiers, they might need some more support, which is also not present right now. So I want to explain two technical ideas about Scribus. So the first one is the way how we store text right now in Scribus, which is not optimal. So if we have a text, so this is just the beginning of a text, like four characters. And the way we do it now, that we have for each character, we store all the style attributes, which is present in the character style, plus the glyph it finally ends up with. So the glyph is practically the number of the index of this character in the font, and also the position on the page where it ends. So. And if you can see, if you have a simple text, this would be like 2 bytes, 1 or 2 bytes per character if you just store it. And the way we have it here, so each character could be 100 bytes or more. So if you ever wondered why Scribus needs a lot of memory, that's one of the reasons. So that has to change, and it will change in 1.3.6 right now. So what we just want to do is that we have a so-called Q string, which is from our library, where the string is chars, and we will just store the characters themselves, That will take like 2 bytes per character. And all the other information will be stored elsewhere. So of course now we have to keep track on where to put it. So we will have character style runs and we will have paragraphs. We have an extra data structure which tells us, for example, the first 3 characters have 1 style, which is stored somewhere. Then we have the 4th character and a paragraph separator. And then we have a 3rd character style run which starts at character 6 and goes to the end. And also we have to keep track of a position of a paragraph separator, because each paragraph can have different paragraph styles. So with that information, we then link the paragraph styles we need and the paragraph style just to the three runs and this one paragraph. And so this is a lot less information than we have if we had to store the whole character file information for each character. So, okay, once we are doing this, of course, we can attach even more information to that. And one thing we will need in the future, in my opinion, to enable more stuff, is to have XML tags in the text. Okay, there's a page mix-up. That's the page we need. So what you now see here is we have another data structure which tells us at which positions in the text we have XML tags. And I put two tags right here for a paragraph start, paragraph end, for example. But it could be anything. It could be by a span or something else, or named address also. The idea is to support generic XML with drivers. So usually you would not see these elements, but drivers would keep them. It would store the XML attributes needed, and also write it back to disk when the file was saved. So this information would be inside the Scribus document. It will stay there, and there's a way to extend the functionality of Scribus by using special XML dialects to do this. Okay, then right now that does not make that much sense because you would like to, yes?
A quick question.
Deliberately made that a non-well-formed fragment just to show that that's what you can store, or is that just an accident? Is your string an arbitrary string that may contain closing and opening tags and any sort of random combination, or?
Well, I think it's the only thing which is missing is a root element, yes. You would have usually a root element, otherwise it's well-formed.
There's no opening key?
No, because it's a paragraph separator. It's not paragraph separator is not an XML tag. It's a normal character. In this case.
Okay.
Of course, that's it. We have only 2p tags.
Yes.
1 opening, 1 closing.
Right.
Okay. This p there is a paragraph separator.
Yeah, that wasn't confusing. It was the fact that there was no
root element.
There's no root element,
that's right.
But that might be deliberate. You might be saying we can store any sequence and we just insert these things in.
Yes.
Sort of
yes.
Or you might be saying, no, it will be XML, but I can show it.
We can do both.
It's so we can take
So usually we will have a root element, but we don't care which root element it is really. So now the thing is how we can connect the XML attributes.
One more quick.
Yes?
On that, it just sounds like there's a minor shift in approach and thinking about it, that when I've seen it over the years done the wrong way, it leads to problems, and done the right way, it simplifies things, is that think just want to make sure you don't end up with thinking about XML as sequences with tags in them, but rather elements that just happen to have tags delimiting them. And they're actually elements, just like you have care style runs there, you'd have element runs. And there would be a tag corresponding to the beginning and ending of each run or such. There was a corresponding structure that's not called out right now in what you have up there.
Yes. We have two possibilities to do it. Either we could store it as an XML structure, or we keep it as a flat structure as we use it right now. And the idea I'm presenting here is that we keep our flat structure. So we have a sequence of characters with XML tags in it. And we would enforce that you have a closing tag for each opening tag, and it's well formed. So we might not have a root element, but otherwise it should be well formed.
Okay, so that's
yes?
One of the things.
Yes.
If you do conceptually at least keep it as elements with beginnings and endings, then that's what you get from the requirement of,
yes.
Requirement of being well formed.
Yes. So non-well formed XML really doesn't make that much sense. So one thing, of course, is the paragraph separator is a special car for special character in XML, and gets converted to whitespace, gets normalized. So we will have a special encoding for that, and stuff like that. So the XML format is not really nice to whitespace, I must say. And whitespace is a big issue with typesetting. Okay, so now we have some structure in it, but Scriabos is not using it. So now the idea how to connect this, which is of course CSS, cascading style sheet, because we can have CSS formatting in these attributes. I'll just talk about the case where you have a local style attribute in XML to use this. And we can use the display attribute from CSS to tell us if we have a paragraph, if it's a paragraph element, a block element, or if it's just an inline element and other stuff. And in the future, we could also support the other display values, which is none for not showing at all, and of course the table ones, which I think a lot of people are waiting for too. So, yeah, and the other thing is then we can look what kind of char file attributes we have. Metron, so CSS, if there is a correspondence, we can just reuse the CSS attributes for Scriabos and take them. But on the other hand, we will not support all XML attributes. So especially like the interactive ones, of course, are no-no for us. And we will need additional character file attributes which are not present in CSS at that time. I've seen there's another talk about fonts and what kind of font attributes CSS should support, and I'm very interested in seeing that.
In addition to CSS, have you looked at XSL, which is intended for, it's much like CSS, but it's intended for print largely?
Mm-hmm. XSL?
Yes, XSL FO.
XSL
Accessible Style Sheet Language for
over formatting objects.
You might look at it.
Yeah, I know about it, but it's not really that. We don't want to take the. We don't want to use a special element structure really, because the idea is right now the text is stored internally in a scriber document, but we want to have it external too. So, and then we want to have a good interoperation with web standards and with content, not the formatting. Scribers will do the formatting itself, but there is a lot of content which is generated as XML content, starting with HTML and whatever. And so we could just use it like that. And we would just interpret the CSS attributes in a certain style to attach our scriber styles to it. Yeah. So you could also have a dual use. So you have an external XML file, and it's linked to a scriber's document for layout, and it takes that there. And you can also just show this same file in a web browser or in a content management system.
Speaking of CSS, you mentioned earlier about HTML as a possible output format. You might consider HTML and prints, which is a, for instance, CSS printing point, printing profile.
Yes. I was not... talking about a certain HTML dialect or version, but XHTML is definitely should be the choice, yes. Okay. Yeah, so this is just one of ideas where scribers could go, and this, of course, would, first of all, it allows to put structured text within scriber story, which is now just a sequence of characters. And also, of course, if it's available for Scripter, we can produce other plugins which build on that and make special stuff. And for example, if you want to have something like footnotes and stuff like that, we can put them into XML tags and just fish them out and produce them differently. But first, we need to have some way to store XML tags within scribers. And once we have a structure, of course, we can use the structure to do a special layout. Okay. So that's this idea. Let's have to see where's the next. No? Okay, roles. Maybe forget this picture for right now. The idea is, I guess you all have used scribers. And you know, first you have to put a text frame or several text frames, and then you have to link them. Yeah? And the alternative is when you create a document, say you want to have auto text frames. Then you get one text frame for each page, and it's automatically linked, which is kind of nice, but it's kind of limited too, because you have just like a normal word processor. So if you have a magazine, usually you have more complicated ways how to the frames are linked. And of course, then you have to do it manually, which is error prone and not that nice. So the idea is if you have these four text frames right here, you would put a role to each text frame. So the two text frames on the left have a role English for English text, and the two other text frames have a role French for French text. And this is just arbitrary role names. You don't really need, it could be anything. Yeah? And then you have another attribute which tells you link to and a role name. So the idea is once you have roles, you can automatically link them using this link to. So in this case, English would be linked to English text and French to French text. And if you say like the top two text frames are on a master page and you repeat this master page, yeah, you would automatically link two parallel stories, one for English text and one for French text. That's just one case. Another case would be if you have a magazine and you just say, okay, I use a new role for each story I have and put this in the text frames. So, and they are automatically linked. And yeah, there are uses for that too. So for example, we could define in the future, define special roles for text frame just to take up footnotes. So we have footnote frames and they were linked to the rest and they would just automatically fill, the text would automatically spill over to the next footnote frame and stuff like that. Here. So, just a small idea of what to do. Yeah, that would be the end of my talk, and it's supposed to be an open discussion, and I would say you can just add something to the ideas I had, it's just for getting started, or just propose any other ideas for future directions for scribes, and we can go on discussing it over the next days. Questions?
I really like the rules.
Yeah? Thanks. I think they are going to be implemented in a Google Summer of Code project, which I'm mentoring. And because it's the main purpose is the improvement of master pages, because if you know scribes, there's one limitation with our master pages. If you have a text frame on it, it stays just like it is, and you cannot edit this text frame. And this Google project is aimed at changing that, so that you can pull elements from a master page and edit them on a local page as you want. Yes.
I especially wonder what the structured plan is to achieve that.
Well, the structured plan to achieve that would be first to make a structured plan. And so we right now we don't have any developer who focuses especially on usability. So one thing is, for example, we could define something like a metabug or a bug theme, which just takes up all usability stuff and just decides to work on these bug reports on usability to improve stuff. And yeah, but right now we don't have anyone who could do that systematically right now.
Yeah, but the interest me, of course, is okay, it's a nice team. Who is with you to help you with the usability issues, in finding direction, maybe designing your directions where you are can be going?
We're not really in contact. I mean, it's basically piece of feedback at this point.
Yes. So one of the important things really is user feedback. So we have a very close communication with users. We have our IRC channel, which is well visited. We have a mailing list. So we just know what people are complaining about, and we try to improve it on that. Yeah, so that's just maybe a dynamic approach. But there's nothing systematically which would like say, okay, this has to be like that, and there should be some style guide which controls how the GUI should look like and stuff like that. We don't have that at the moment. And if someone else wants to give us input for that, so they're always welcome.
Yeah, maybe it's good during these days to chat. Discord board. One hint I can give, and don't know what Michael thinks of saying, but just about the worst way to do something about your usability is open a very direct dialogue between developers and users, actually. It is actually the worst way to do it, to do something like you. You just get a dependency cycle of more features, we can give you more features, we can give you more stuff, we want more stuff. And it takes usability specialists to really get your usability on the road. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
But
So Petra, would you suggest making open usability project and Scribus?
I got the ball. Okay. In general, I would say that if you want to put as one of your four priorities for where to go, well, actually three, because following Impress wasn't your so much a priority, then you need to start working with people who can do the empirical work, so people who can do usability studies, how people are doing of your very specific target user group, because that's what impressed me in the first place about Scribus. You know what you are doing. You know who you are doing it for and what you're trying to achieve. So that's already step one. It's not like for everybody, because then you can be saved. You know who you're doing for, studies in how well they can work with on aiming for a very professional level would be number one there. Once you've sorted out really what goes well and what gets in their way and what there may be very old problems that they've lived in these kinds of programs since PageMaker forever, once you figure those out, then it's about working together with your usability people about how these workflows can be improved, how old dogmas can maybe be broken. But in general, the advice is get professional help. You need to see somebody for this, yes. So it means really getting serious and getting to the point where you want to get people involved and you learn to live together inside the project with usability professionals who will help you on the way to making things in the application really flow better for your target user group. That's first and foremost. Was that okay?
Yep.
There you go.
Do you plan any other specific performance improvements besides the text? Like, I've been trying to collaborate with other people and trying to convince them to use Scribus, and well, when you're working on tight deadlines, performance at a certain point is a stumbling block.
When what?
When you're working on heavy deadlines,
yes.
Then you want to do things quickly. Like, well, in Scribus, things are much more heavy than in the programs they used to use. So that's at a certain point they quit, even though they were willing to not work.
I think we have three major areas which make it slow. One is text. For various reasons, because we do text or layout all the time and we cache very little. The next is big images. So, usually we have to be able to load the whole image into memory and maybe also a copy of it to work with it. And that takes a lot of RAM. So that can be improved. We have been toying with the idea to integrating WIPs, for example. There's another talk this week about WIPs. And the third thing, which is not quite obvious, but might be the worst thing at all is the event system. We are using events internally. And so my feeling is we don't have real control what events are fired in what order and how much time they take. And for example, we had a speed up from 1.2 to 1.3 when Mr. Beef weeded out lots of this unnecessary event handling. And we had some more performance improvement just at the end of 1.3.5, because one user provided us a nice run a profile on Scribus and identified several areas where just small areas where a small change could make a big improvement. So that should continue over time also. I think it was mainly about text layout, though.
Also about the PDF export, like when you PDF export in Scribus, it also exports everything, even though the image might be cropped.
Yes.
Is that something you like, or is it? I mean, do you consider it a feature, or do you consider it something you want to work on?
Right now, I don't think we see the real need to address it that urgently, no. So for now, we target print PDFs. And if you have, I think Cedric also wanted to ask something. If you want to do it for web or just for stream viewing a PDF, you would make different choices how to produce a PDF, and cropping images and reducing resolution is one. I think you can, in PDF export already, you can send a maximum resolution. So if you say put that to 300 dpi, it should render the images at 3 dpi, and I think it also crops it then. So once it touches it, I think it also crops, but if it does not have to do anything, it doesn't do anything. And especially with JPEGs, it's best not to touch them. Because if you unpack JPEG and try to read it, it's not a lossless transformation, and you might have artifacts.
The two blocks of text
yes.
is defined by the language. But for example, in the block of English text, there's some word included in their origin language. For
yeah.
example, for the proper names,
mm-hmm.
Chinese or whatever. And when we define it to
that's. I think you are thinking about a different case there. This is just arbitrary row names. Instead of English and French, I could also just use A and B, and then link to A, link to B. So it's just because we are in Canada, and there's a lot of bilingual documents in Canada. So this was also an example I took. It could be arbitrary. You are not limited to two roles, and it's not supposed to be language names over time. We have a language attribute, which is a character attribute, and it's independent of these roles. Yeah, any text can be any language, and currently I think it's only used for hyphenation. So, any more questions? Dinner time? Okay.
Thank you.